Hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Dragons in Space. This is episode number 44. And we are resuming our alternate Twitch campaign, still waiting for Near Future to come out and be released for 1.3. Looks like it's not, and let's see where we left off. Oh, yeah, we're trying to get the nuclear propulsion unlocked. In the meantime, let's see if we have any new missions available. We just recently recovered a lot of Kerbals from orbit. Still have one we can't have quite recovered yet. We got 4 out of 5 of them. Calls for science data from the two bodies, as well as surveys. Looks like we'll be going to the moon. Unless there's something close for us to do. An atmosphere. There we are. And no, all this is on the other side of the planet. We've got a call for another high-altitude satellite. That'll help us with strengthening CurveNet. Making it more reliable, so we'll go ahead and do that. Oh, it led up to CONSAT 1 launcher. You just a quick pre-flight inspection. Everything looks good. Staging still looks good. Gorgeous Milky Way background there. I remember when I get back to clear out all the extra space junk that we no longer need. So that is in Eastern orbit, so it'll be easy to match. Silene right off the pad heading east. And that is Space Cat deciding to join us this evening. Is looking good. Earthening over a little more now that we've penetrated the clouds. Switch over to orbit view. Start matching our orbit here. Just wanting to tip over the rest of the way, but we're not going to let it. Get us some boosters. We have a mostly clean separation, except for that one, which is knocking us end over end. Well, good news is we should be able to recover that pretty easy. Okay, we're good. I have attitude control thuds on this, but they don't appear to be on here. Interesting. Maybe I'm thinking of a different vessel. Probably the tourist vessel. Gorgeous sun flare over there. Thank God rays turned on, but we're not getting any for some reason. Hey, Jay. Welcome aboard. Just putting a satellite into orbit, then we're going to head to the moon. Trying to strengthen CurbNet a little bit so we don't lose contact. Is putting a satellite up. The apoapsis is all the way out here. I might be able to hit that with this rocket. with this stage. Going for it. Yeah, close. NoseCon got a little warm. Alright, separating first, second stage. Second stage is clean, igniting the third. Before we get out of range, we'll go ahead and unleash this fairing. And deploy the communication net. We just deployed the antennas using a hotkey. Oop, forwarded a little. We'll use the monopropellant to bring it back just slightly. It looks like it's be like behind the mark, but it's actually past it. One of those cases where camera angle means everything. Alright, so we're going to accelerate time to right about here. If it'll let us. I don't think it'll let us go that far. Oh, yeah, it will. Whoa, we are way below. We've got some adjustments to do once we get to the ascending node. Now we need to match the periapsis, and then we can hit the ascending node on the way around and adjust the attitude of the orbit. We don't want to fire at orbit, we want to fire at the horizon because we're right exactly at where the where we want the apoapsis to be, and it's a little before where the apoapsis actually is in the orbit right now. Matter of fact, we kind of want to bring that down towards the horizon, so we'll do that while we're making this burn, matching it to the 7.355 million on the other side. We've almost got it exactly where we want it now. Just a matter of tweaking the altitude. Remember, camera angle is everything on this. So just make sure the altitude numbers match up, and then we can correct the attitude, which will make the camera angles look right. Overshot just slightly, so we'll tweak the monopropellant, and now we're just about exact. We can't get any closer than that. Oh, circular orbits around planetary bodies? I can eyeball them. I need no maneuver nodes. Okay, take care. Have a good night. Thank you for the compliment. I'll just go to the ascending node here. For the ascending node, what we're going to do is we're going to fire towards 180 degrees relative to the planet. Thank you, you as well. And we have matched. Hardly any adjustment. Just waiting for the game to realize it and give us the updated information. Mission complete. And then we have another relay. KerbNet is looking really solid now. We've got multiple relay points, multiple bodies involved. I don't think we have a satellite around Mimas yet, though. We might need to do that next. They've got plenty of fuel on board satellite for orbital adjustment missions when they come up later in game. I like to do that because it means free money. And we do have a mission for Mimas in a colonial orbit, which will give us a really high altitude satellite above Mimas, which will be frequently exposed to KerbNet access. So I really like that plan. We're going to put that satellite up too. We'll do that one next. We can use the same body because that body has enough fuel to easily get us to Mimas. However, before we do that, I want to name this thing. Let's go do that right quick. We want to name that satellite so we don't lose track of it. We also need to name that one, so we'll name it as well. The E is for the orbit, so it's orbiting eastwards, so we designate it with an E. Basically put some information about the name, about the satellite, and what its purpose is. We'll go back to tracking station now, do the same for the other satellite. We're going to call this one in high eastern orbit because it's close to the moon. This one's still in its antinormal position from when we're adjusting its elevation. Not quite geosynchronous. It's a little slower than the orbit of the planet. But it's close. Galactus is currently directly above the Space Center, too. Good relay position. As a matter of fact, we really do need a... I hope they give us a geosynchronous mission above the space station. And when I get the ability to create my own missions, when they come out with a new mod pack that allows you to custom create your own missions, one of the first early missions I want to make available is to put a geosynchronous communication satellite directly above the Space Center. Well, that's like the most powerful relay point you can have is directly above your main communication satellite tracking station. I think that's all the satellites' names. Let's just verify that. And so we'll go ahead and get on with our Minmus mission. That's no longer really a moon probe. We're like a deep space relay at this point with not a lot of range at that. Question this utility value. Maybe we should get rid of it. Very limited range, just a couple of relays. But currently it still has contact, so we'll leave it. DSR is for deep space retirement. Or parking, however you want to call it. We have a probe landed at Kerbin? Let me guess, I flew something I forgot to bring it home. Oh. Debris from a failed mission. Well, not a failed mission, a test, more or less. We can recover that. Matter of fact, we should check for debris. That appeared to have a few pieces nearby that we may want to pick up. No need to have the game tracking it if it doesn't need to be there. A lot of debris. There we are, nice clean airspace. Well, that's the other thing we need to do. We need to check to see if any of these have kerbals still in them, because if not, we need to get rid of them. Do we still have a mission to recover from orbit? Bagels. Where is Bagel? Beebles, where is your boat, Beebles? I don't see your boat anywhere. I think we're about to fail that mission. It may have been lost when we updated. One of the mods and it appeared to remove one of the cockpits. And on. I feel like we're missing stuff. The thing about changes to mods happening so frequently around this for recent update, you lose those sometimes. No, we got our biplane cockpit here. Must just have temporarily vanished when there's a period where we didn't have everything. Go ahead and fail that mission because it's just going to keep holding a mission slot. Beagle's Kerbin. Low Kerbin orbit. You know, Jagman's supposed to be up there, but I don't see a Beagle anywhere. So fellow Beagles, because that one's no longer in orbit. Then we're going to toss our Kerbin set up, or Moon set, Minmus set up. I'll get it right eventually. Just keep guessing orbital bodies, eventually I'll get to the right one. Sorry, Beagles, we can't save you. Yeah, we felt the same way. Okay, so reload the comm set. Comm out works extremely well. This one's going to Minmus. Minmus may be able to send back enough tech to get us our nuclear engines. Although I think our labs may actually be more important than our nuclear engines at this point. No, the nuclear engines will help us get the labs to the moon. The efficiency levels on them are so high. And as we did the last time, we're going to do a slight lean off the pad to the east. Some of that good old forward momentum going. And we are looking good. Another gorgeous night mission. I think we're just a little pre-dawn. Now at high enough altitude we can start nosing over. We'll go to a 45 degree orbit if we can. That's good. And we have clean separation, engaging liquid motor. That went much better than last time. I just didn't fire that liquid motor fast enough last time. We will now level out the flight just a little. We've got an aquaps getting very close to orbit. Well, orbit altitude, I should say. Not quite close to orbit yet. Got a long burn ahead of us. Good on orbit altitude. Let's see if we can plan that orbit out. Okay, now I need to find minimus. What we're going to do is we're going to get to the ascending node. We're going to alter down, then not far past the ascending node, we're going to start expanding our orbit to try to match up with minimus. So to counter the ascending node, we need to actually be descending. So let me go ahead and jettison our shield so we can maneuver with thrusters. Goodbye. We're going into an antinormal position to counter the ascent node. Ideally, if you have a navigation computer, you just lock it on anti-normal and let it go until you get the right attitude, but we're going to have to do it manually here. Fortunately, we got good curve net coverage right now. Also, let's go ahead and extend the antennas on this. I forgot to do that. There we go. There we stay in contact. We want to begin our burn on the ascending node. Correct that down to 0 degrees if we can. That's about as close as we want to get, 2 degrees. We want to flatten out to back to 90. Now the other push we need to know is what altitude is the orbit we're targeting around minimus and which direction is it. So what we'll need to do is we'll need to keep burning until we're able to match that orbit. Well, at least one of the altitudes of the orbits, apoapsis or periapsis. So we'll zoom in on minimus here. Oh yes, that Colonia. So we want to go under minimus if we can. From the angle we'll be approaching at. This will actually cause for some calculations. So now we got our encounter, we need to know where it's going to pass minimus. That is almost perfect. Wow, that is a great match. We'll just have to tilt it some. Okay, so we're going to keep that right there. That's where we want to hit it. So back to our normal view here. We are close to making that burn right now. Oh, we ran out of gas. Alright, next stage. Need this burn. We missed it slightly. Alright. That's as close as we're going to get it. Now the real question is, how far did we screw it? Looks like we hurt pretty bad. We missed it by a lot. We're going to have to correct that. And we're going to do it with RCS. Bingo. All right, we're dead on target. All right, it's got to accelerate time to the rendezvous. And once again, we just accelerate until we get close to the periapsis so that we can slow things down. Actually, we want to start doing that now because we need to get that periapsis lower. To get that periapsis lower, what we want to do is we want to find out where. Alright, so there is. Our anti-grade path. We're going to burn slightly towards that, try to get this orbit to come up. Want it to match 9,300 meters. Now the other thing to note is that this is also the same spot where the pivot point is. We're going to be wanting to burn anti-normal, I believe, based on the orientation. Rick is finding anti-normal in this type of strange configuration of an orbit. You have to rely on your nav ball here. Try to use electrical power as much as you can to maneuver rather than using using the thrusters because that'll conserve your fuel and make the satellite more useful going forward. So let's start testing its burnout, see if it's going to burn in the right direction. No, it's not. But we do need normal after all. Not quite a match, but we're getting close. So the apoapsis is now correct. Periapsis is still off quite a bit, but we can correct that when we get around. Descending node is still a bit of a problem. Only 1 degree off now on the descending node, so we'll be able to fix that soon. What we're doing is using the monopropellant to ever so slightly adjust the orbit in. Actually, we'll revert to using liquid because it's faster. And there we have it. Bingo. And now we really have a strong curve net. This will complement that. And so as long as either one of them is in view of Kerbin, which most of the time one of them will be, then this will serve as a relay. Ooh, that was some good tech. That may be enough to get our nuclear engines. Let's go check and see. Do we have labs unlocked yet? That's something else I'm curious about. No, we do not. We are 150 away from them. They're kind of important. I think the nukes are more important, though. The nukes will let us do missions all the way around the planet. We need something for really high heat tolerance. We don't have thermal systems we need yet to do what I'm wanting to do. How to protect a science lab, like the small science junior. Oh, clever. That'll work. Oh, I thought it would. That may work. So if we want to do this, I need to have it turned up so that I can actually see the science on board. Like that. Hope it doesn't have any problems functioning like that. Gotta shield that too, somehow. You know, that container was that huge. It still has some room that it can move down. Like that. Thank you. That actually looks really good positioned. want to get the Kerbals on and off this ship. We don't have letters unlocked yet. Fueling ports in case we'd ever decide to make a Terran base somewhere. It's our first attempt at a nuclear thermal space plane in this campaign. We don't have any letters for it yet. This is purely a test design. Just need to get a little bit of momentum to get some air moving across the intake here. Like a can thing. Okay, so the one problem we have is we can't get up to 20 meters per second. So we need to find an assisting rocket. Because the early ram jet will not light up on its own on the runway. It has to have an efficiency increase from tech later to do that. So what we're going to do is I'm going to give it some boost engines. All I need is a Mark Zero intake, people. That'll work. Laguna is here. I'll set a toggle on to turn them on and off. That way we'll have a way to reignite. We ever have to land it somewhere. There we go, nuclear thermal engines taking over now. Get off the Mark 1s, Mark 0 jets because we no longer need them. And that was a beautiful liftoff. Question is, will it land just as beautifully? How well does it control? What I've seen so far really wants to hyper maneuver. Really wants to hyper maneuver. Problem with that is it wants to flip from it. That may help some. Try this again. You might be wondering, why haven't we gone to the moon yet? The reason we haven't gone to the moon yet is I want to get a science lab in place before we start doing stuff on the moon, because it can be a little difficult to get that technology. And having to make multiple trips to fuel a science lab just is not efficient, so you get it all in one go. It's just a nice takeoff for a craft like this. Not hyper-maneuvering, it's properly maneuvering. Good maneuverability, even at low speeds. It just doesn't recover well from low altitude because of how heavy it is. We expect that though from a nuclear engine. I'm liking what I'm seeing so far. Doesn't require a large amount of space for takeoff, which is always a good thing. Now keep in mind, this thing doesn't actually use any fuel, except for the starter jets, which we can shut off now. Starting to get a little warm. very stable at high altitude and high speeds. I'm really liking this design layout. Really amazing, isn't it? This altitude, this engine is still pulling air in. Welcome aboard, Rubeload. Unfortunately, I do not understand Russian. So what we've got here is a nuclear space plane using a nuclear thermal ramjet engine from the Interstellar mod. It runs on pure atmosphere, doesn't actually require fuel, just oxygen and uranium. Can theoretically stay in the air for hundreds of years if needed. I'm trying to see if I can get it into space, but I don't think I'm going to be able to. I don't think the engine is efficient enough yet. I may need a few upgrades or a engine that will kick it out of orbit, into orbit. From the cockpit right now. Gorgeous cockpit. How well she turned at this speed. Okay, so I'm going to take from that that she doesn't turn at this speed. Thank you for the follow. Now, this is a simulation. We're just testing the aerodynamic properties of this particular craft. Trying to get it rolled back upright, but it's having trouble doing that because of the lack of atmosphere and the lack of momentum. Now the nuclear engine is getting really hot right now. The reason it's getting hot is it doesn't have enough airflow to cool it. So as we can tell, stalls are extremely unhealthy for this type of craft. We'll kick on our actual liquid engines just to give it an assist in trying to recover from the stall. We have successful stall recovery. We are now also heading back in the direction where we came from, which was the objective. We wanted to go back to base. We're going to see how well it lands. I've turned off the liquid assist engines to conserve their fuel. We should see the nuclear thermal ramjet start to cool down now that it's got airflow. We have lost the air control surface. No, we've lost an intake. Oh, and it overheated. Cockpit survived, though. We had a parachute on this. The Kerbal would survive. But that's the whole point of these tests. See what this thing can endure. Obviously, we don't have the thermal control systems available yet to get it beyond 1,300 meters per second at low altitude safely. So we'll have to do that later after we get some graphene wings and such. Graphene radiators, graphene nose cone. Poor Jeb. All right, I'd say that test was a resounding success. We just need to get some better technology. All right, so we're going to leave the X1 alone for a while. We're going to go to the moon. We need some more tech. We're going to send a basic probe up. this was our original moon probe. It was actually just meant to bypass the moon and take pictures of it, not to actually land on it. We're going to have to get something more up to date. Same story here, not really meant to land on it. We need a lander is what we need. And these right here, these candle engines make for beautiful probes. I mean, they will last forever on the moon. All we need is a means to mount them. That should do nicely. They only need liquid fuel, so we'll only use liquid. We can use hydrogen, or we can use liquid. Due to the fact it's the moon, I'm inclined to use the hydrogen due to the increased efficiency of hydrogen. Question is, will this tank do hydrogen? Doesn't appear so. We'll need to see if we have any dedicated hydrogen tanks. Bit large. That should work well. Got a long burn time on it too. Thank you. Now it's going to need some science too. This is going to want a payload and a fairing, and we're done with it. And I think we're done with it, except for giving it something to land on. That should work just nicely. Barely enough clearance, but just enough to do the job. Now, just in case we land on the dark side of the moon, or want a little light, a real good spot to put these. Put them under here. That works. Got a lot of power. I need comms. I have any communication satellites yet? Or communication antennas? Now this thing doesn't need a lot of antennas because it's got an array in orbit above it. Just a couple should do the job. I think that's everything we need on this one. What if we did liquid, if it would last longer? Let's see. Need a burn methane? I don't think they do. Nope, just liquid fuel and hydrogen. Yeah, liquid would last a whole lot longer. We'll have to stick with that. Won't have a very high TWR, but that's on Kerbin. On the moon, that's a decent TWR for the moon. Okay. Save that. Yes. We're going to merge that with CONSAT 1, auto save ship. Now the reason we're merging that is to get rid of a piece of it. Actually, we want to load this one up. I already had this as a sub-assembly. Yes, I do. Okay. Well, that thing was complicated. We don't want something like that. Matter of fact, we want to scrap that old design. It's garbage. Especially compared to this nice little efficient little beast. Grab this sub-assembly system here. What we gotta do is we gotta get it connect at one of the interstitial nodes. Problem is it's got a three-way design. And it keeps wanting to connect on one of the three-way nuclear engine modules, which is not healthy. I think I need to take a different approach to this. And I think I know how. Thank you. That will work a whole lot better. More fuel, more delta V, all around better. And there we go, nice protective shell for it. Although maybe a little more bloated than I wanted. That looks a lot better. Next sequencing. It's a little heavier than that ComSat, but it should still make it to the moon. See how she goes. How they do with the ComSat, we'll do a little bit of a lean over at the start. Just enough to get our forward momentum going. Systems nominal. Livery is looking really good. beginning roll to 45 degree ascent angle. This thing does not like that. Okay, so we know the rocket's still a little top heavy. We'll want to get some guidance fin on the front of the boosters. Make sure it's able to hit the 45 degrees and stabilize there. So we will put a couple of guidance fins on the front here. Why does that seem off center? Because it is. Somehow the craft got slightly rotated beneath everything. Really? Do that. That straightened it out. I'll fix the top fins though that we added after an afterthought because, well, I had to do it all. These are not straight. Are these? It should be now, though. I wonder if that's true on a CommSat satellite rocket, too, and I just hadn't noticed it. No, let's just reconnect those, they look weird. Okay, it looks right now. Very picky about alignment. Have to be with rockets. Let's get this thing into the moon now. We're changing over to mission mode. Lane separation. Lane launch. Getting these for lean. You have a 45-degree ascent angle, which would be good. Won't be one. Testing stage one SRBs. Initializing liquid booster. Flying fairing. And we forgot to add RCS to the probe. Hopefully it'll be fine on its own. Controls. Also, I forgot to add some SAS to it as well. We'll still probably make it though. Still a relatively nominal launch at this point. Plenty of fuel still left over. Yeah, orbit looking for the moon now. this target. We're not off by much on the orbital slope, so what we'll do is we'll come over to, we'll warp to this side. So that's the point where we'll want to start burning to actually reach the moon. Now slow things down a little because we got to turn our craft to be able to maneuver to get to the moon. We should be about a good point to begin our ascent. I want to aim at the horizon and make sure that the orbit's going out directly to the opposite side of the planet. If you drew a line from the ship to the planet's core, you go up exactly opposite to it. And we just ran out of fuel on the second stage, so launching the third. While we're burning, we're correcting the orbit as well. I want to focus our view on the moon right quick and see where that's taking us. That's a little further than I wanted. We'll just have to do a west approach instead. That should be perfect. Now what will happen is I'll be able to burn and land on the bright side close to where dawn is starting to come around the moon. My westward approach. We just established communications with the Moon Operation Satellite. As long as our probe is on the same side of the moon as that satellite, when it starts to land, we'll be in good shape. And it looks like it will be. Alright, we need to burn to counter our momentum. We're intentionally coming in pretty shallow here. This will tell us our trajectory, allow us to plot us a nice flat spot to land. I'm seeing a nice flat spot right in there. We want to go over that a little. Well, trying to land between these two craters here should be a nice flat spot. That we could land right where we're at, because that's flat too. Separated probe away from the delivery system here. Just one problem. Too heavy. I expected to spend more fuel getting down to the ground, but we didn't have to. Good news is all of our science missions are still intact, even though our probe is pretty much stuck. So we will just do our science radio at home and be done with it. Note to self. Still needs more thrusters. Still needs more heat control. Also could use some RCS. RCS would have saved us. And so would SAS. We got some improvements to make to this design. But for right now, let's send our tech home. We're on the moon. That's the important bit. And we landed somewhere we've already landed before. Means all this is a waste. Unless we can get this thing back in the air somehow. This was anticlimactic. With F5 on the way in. Oh, and now I'm out of comms as well. That is funny. How am I on the comms, though? Satellite just passed around. We just left the whirling dervish on the moon. And that will be forever coming back around into contact range. It tells me Kerbnet needs better development around the moon as well before we take it and try to do another moon landing. At least with probes. It'd take forever to wait for the satellite to come around and shut that down, so we're just going to revert. That'll be my weekly mulligan. Take it back into vehicle assembly and let's fix the problems. That should help with any control issues we have. At least on the bottom stage. Alright, let's go up here. We need to work on control and SAS. Will be our monoprop tanks. That should work a lot better. And that should work a lot better. Unfortunately, I've run out of time to play tonight. We will resume tomorrow night with this launch and put the Moonlander probe on the surface of the moon in a new biome than the one that we've already visited. So, probably at one of the poles. So, I look forward to seeing you tomorrow evening, or tomorrow morning, around 2 a.m. Eastern Time, and we will resume where we left off. Thank you for watching.